both here in Nigeria and on the African continent. My guest had the rare privilege of working with three different administrations, military and civilian. My guest, above all, fought for and won the concept of a minimum wage for Nigerian workers. My guest was the pioneer president of the Nigeria Labour Congress as we have it today. In that position, he fought for the Nigerian worker. And after that, he left for higher position on the African continent, where he continued as the General Secretary of the Organization of African Trade Union Unity, OATU. It's therefore my pleasure to welcome on set my guest, Comrade Hassan Adebayo Sumunu, OON. Sir, you're welcome to the program.
Thanks so much.
First of all, let me say that it's a pleasure meeting you one-on-one.
Thank you.
We've heard so much about you and your love for the Nigerian worker. But we don't seem to know who Hassan Sumunu, OON, is. May we just have a little bit of your growing up years?
Well, I was born on 7th of January 1941 with an identical twin brother, Hussein, who, like me, studied civil engineering at the Yaba College of Tech. And while I was elected as president, the founding president of Nigeria Labour Congress, the Federal Minister of Works, where we started same day, you know, sponsored him to go and do his master's degree in engineering at Leeds University. So we were born here, and this is our home, Oshogbo. Of our parents are both from Oshogbo, our grandparents also from Oshogbo. And now growing up years, we had a very good and memorable time because one, Yorubas love twins. In fact, Yorubas deify twins. And because we are identical twin brothers, we had everything to ourselves because the Yorubas believe that twins bring luck into the family. And the women selling all sorts of wares within our area at Odeyemi's compound at Oshogbo here, about 3.5-4 kilometers away from this place, used to bring their wares every morning to our house and ask my twin brother and I just to touch their wares. And they believe that within an hour they will sell out. And that's actually what used to be the case. So we had very nice, you know, background at home. You know, our parents lived in Ghana for 40 years, the old Gold Coast. My father from 1925 to 1965. In fact, we brought them back home in 1965. When we were sensing, you know, the last of the days we went there, that things might not be all that. And it was 4 years later that the Busia regime, you know, passed the law, the aliens must go law that affected many Nigerians. So our parents didn't, you know, suffer that particular episode. So we went to the Ansaruddin School. We started at Ansaruddin School, Oshogbo here. On Sabo Road, but most of our, you know, when anybody says he's a Yoruba person, the only way to know is they actually a Yoruba person, you know, and says I'm from this town or that, you ask what is the name of your compound in that place. So the name of our compound at Oshogbo is Odeyemi's compound, where about 75% of us are Christians, just about 20% Muslim and 5% animist. And most of the animists, you know, died later. And, you know, their children become either Muslims or Christians. So Christians are in the majority. So after 2 years, from 1948 to 1950 at Ansarojin School Oshogbo, we transferred to All Saints School Oshogbo, where majority of the children in our compound, you know, used to attend. And All Saints School Oshogbo used to be the best, you know, primary school in Osun Division, which is now Osun State, you know, at that time. So that's where we were, and we left All Saints School Oshogbo in December 1954. So we were, in 1955, we were admitted to Oshogbo Grammar School, where we attended, but we had a misfortune in the family. Our dad was a cocoa produce merchant in the old Gold Coast, now Ghana. You know, decided to invest his immense fortune from cocoa in diamond business. And he lost everything to the diamond business because it was not his real original business, and it was a new thing. He lost it. So that's why my twin brother and I had to withdraw from Oshogbo Grammar School in 1956 in Form 2. And then went to meet them in the Gold Coast then, because it was then a year to Ghana's independence, 6th of March 1957. So we were there from May 1956, May, to February 1956, just before Ghana's independence. We came back home, took the entrance exam to the Yaba Technical Institute, now Yaba College of Tech, because that time Yaba Technical Institute used to have a secondary school section, only 4 years. In 4 years, we passed all these exams, O-level, GC, O-level, and so on. You know, but school start, they would not allow us to take, because they said, unless the school, you know, became 5-year program. But in 4 years, we were passing all our GC, O-level, and forgot this thing. So we came to Yaba Technical Institute, the secondary school part of it, in 1957, and then left June 1961, and immediately were employed by the Federal Ministry of Works together, my children and I, you know, and then sent back to the Old Technical Institute, now Yaba College of Tech, to do our ordinary national diploma course in civil engineering as Federal Minister of Works. So my two brother and I, we did our OND there. And then at the, we finished our OND in 1964, because it used to be a sandwich course, not the present day OND. You do just 2 sessions, this now you get your OND, no? You do first 9 months, you go to the field for 15 months practicals, and come back for the final 9 months. That's why from September 1961, we did, you know, to June 1962, and then we had our practicals, and then came back in 1963, September, for the last session. And by June 1964, we were successful in getting our, you know, ordinary national diploma in civil engineering, and we were posted to the headquarters of the Federal Ministry of Works. So that's where we started. But why, okay. You know, so later, a year later, I was one of the lucky students who the Federal Ministry of Works sent for the HND, the National Diploma, in 1965, September, which I completed. My twin brother's chief engineer on Kaduna Zaria Road could not release him. That's why I finished my HND before my my twin brother Hussein, you know. So in 1967, June. So when I finished, I was posted back to the Federal Ministry of Works headquarters and so on.
At what point did you start fighting for the worker?
Well, I think my union teeth were cut while I was at the Yaba Technical Institute, because in my second year at Yaba Technical Institute, our seniors, who are, you know, of year 3, year 4 students, who are our seniors, they had a quarrel. And then the Muslim Student Society of Nigeria, they had elections, and there was a quarrel. And I, in my second year, I was elected secretary of the Yaba Technical Institute branch of the Muslim Student Society of Nigeria. This MSS was formed, was founded by the Adegbites, you know, the Dr. Adegbites and others, and it's late, you know, in 1954. So 3 years after it was formed, you know, we became members, and I was made the secretary. I was elected secretary of the Yaba Technical Institute Muslim Student Society branch. And as secretary of the MSS of the school branch, during the Ramadan festival, there used to be a big cistern for hot water, for tea. And then in the evening, for the early morning medicine, as secretary, I had to come and put on the heater for the cistern to boil the water and go and wake every Muslim student in their various hostels within the Yaba Technical Institute to come and take the Ramadan. So that was, you know, I used to be a shy person, a naturally shy person. But through the Muslim Student Society of Nigeria, you know, all these impromptu speeches and so on and so forth, taking things from the heart and speaking on it, but later, I was also made the class captain from my Form 1 up to the final year. I was to be the school captain, but the Yaba Technical Institute in those days, we had over 55 lecturers, and only two of them were Nigerians. So our European teachers thought that my children and I were too radical for any of us to be made the school captain in our final year. So I still remained class captain, but never the. But when I was doing my HND in 1965 to 67, by session 66, 67, I was elected president of the Yaba College of Tech Students. By then, the old Tengah had become Yaba College of Technology. So I was elected president of Yaba College of Technology Students Union. Then there used to be also the National Association of Technological Students, grouping all the colleges of technology and polytechnics throughout Nigeria. So I also became president of NATS, National Association of Technological Students. So that's where those are the places I caught my unionism teeth. But 1 month after I finished my HND in June 1967, by July 1967, back at the headquarters of the Federal Ministry of Works, I was elected secretary of the, in July of that year, of 1967, secretary of the Association of Technical Officers, Federal Ministry of Works. I was elected as secretary. And you know, this is an association that groups all categories of technical officers, from assistant technical officer in training to the highest level of distinguished, which was then principal technical officer. Because later, when our union fought, we now have chief technical officers, but it used to end as principal technical officer. So all that category of technical officers, I was elected secretary, and we were asked to, you know, we were given a mandate to write, you know, all the grievances and the things that of all categories of members. We wrote that, we finished that by November 1967, and presented to the permanent secretary of the Federal Ministry of Works, the late engineer S.O. Williams. So on the day that listing our grievances for and asking for union management and negotiation, so this is the thing that made me a real trainer, that, you know, was a turning point in my trainer career. At the point of negotiations, when we were about to start the negotiations, the chief labor officer of the ministry asked us whether the Association of Technical Officers was a registered trade union or affiliated to a registered trade union. And the answer was no to both questions. So the chief labor officer told the department secretary, S.O. Williams, and others that there was no point, you know, negotiating anything with these unregistered people because we are representing nobody but ourselves. So that was what actually sent us, and myself and one Mr. Bakari, you know, he's of late memory now, may so rest in peace, were assigned to go and investigate the trade unions, the possible one that our association could affiliate to. So when we did all the search, we now came to Nayaje Street, the headquarters of the Public Works Redone Technical and General Workers, you know, of which the late Wa Goodluck was General Secretary. So we were, because that time, all the technicians in the Federal Ministry of Works and other state ministry of works were members of that, you know. Then the meteorologists, that's why the union was called Public Works Aerodrome, because they used to work in the aerodrome. Meteorologists, they were also part of the. So we recommended, we reported to our, and then our association unanimously accepted that our association should affiliate to Public Works Aerodrome Technical and General Workers Union, of which the late Wa Goodluck was General Secretary. And then we signed Chekhov. I remember the first Chekhov we were able to sign, because most of our members were outside Lagos, was only 169 that were able to sign as Chekhov to become members of the union on the 1st of April 1969. And then on signing the Chekhov, the late Wa Goodluck wrote the ministry and the Department of Sec saying that our association has taken up membership of the union, and that the union is asking for union management negotiation on the basis of the same 10 points that we wanted to discuss. We discussed that, and all the 10 points were won. That was what made the union.
Okay, it's good to at least have this background, but the Nigeria Labour Congress was more or less a loose organization before you came on board. Can we just know how it finally came to be registered as Nigeria Labour Congress?
First and foremost, we used to have more than 1,000 registered trade unions in Nigeria. So when the military government were there, Murtala and later Obasanjo, when they were there, they decided to, because at that time, the military administration banned all political parties. It's only the trade unions that remained unbanned. And they found out that the trade unions were actually doing not only the work of unions, but also, you know, fighting the cause of the ordinary people, the role that, you know, political parties used to do in those days. So they now wanted what they call limited intervention in the trade unions. And as a result of which, first and foremost, they got some of the trade unions. You know, some of our members were drawn by them through their security, this thing, to foment trouble with him. And so it was inaugurated in, I think, January 1976. I remember that January 1976, and we invited foreign guests, you know, from all over the world. They came, and then it was at that place that those who are fifth columnists decided to raise the issue, to say that various spurious allegations, saying that no, Goodluck had a row of houses in the Kodu Road, a row of houses and two petrol stations from money he collected from Moscow.
That's
what happened. Goodluck, and then they said even. The other people who are in ULC, they have collected for money from CIA, from the US, and so on and so forth. So the commissioner for labor that time, because they used to be a commissioner, not minister, as we had it in the military, was the late Brigadier Adefokwe, now late Major General Adefokwe, was then the commissioner. So he refused to attend the meeting, the conference, and as a result of which, We went and still launched the Nigeria Labour Congress at that time, and the government said they are not going to recognize it as a result of the allegations that were made about CIA, KGB, and other involvement, and so on. That's what led to the Justice Adebiyi Commission of Inquiry, which they now instituted. And my brother, I saw people, trade union colleagues who are lying, labor leader number one, Imodu, the late SU Basi, the late Chief Odemi, you know, Akpan, J.U. Akpan. About, you know, 11 of them were banned from taking part in trade unionism, which means that, you know, trade union leadership had been decapitated in order to make in order for them to have a, so we, it's not the first time we see this. So that's what led to what they call intervention in the trade union movement, which led to the restructuring. They decided to now restructure the over 1,000 house unions into industrial unions. So industrial unions, 42 industrial unions that constituted the NLC in the first, and then we have 19 for the, even for the employers, they did also for the employers association, 19 employer, senior staff association, and also for the employers organization. So it was these 42 industrial unions that, you know, had under the supervision of the official of the Federal Ministry of Works that supervised their elections of all the, for instance, my own union, the Public Works, we later changed our name in 1974 to Public Works Construction Technical and General Workers Union, you know, with 27 other unions to be renamed Civil Service Technical Workers Union of Nigeria. As one of the 42 industrial unions that went to Ibadan, you know, on the 28th of February 1978 to launch the Nigeria Labour Congress as we know it today. But it was not to be called Nigeria Labour Congress, because what the Minister of Labour and the Ministry wanted to be the name was CLO, Central Labour Organization. So the late Major General Shehu Yar'Adua, who was number two man to Obasanjo then, came to Ibadan on behalf of the head of state to come and launch it. So the only thing we were able to change at Ibadan on 28 February 1978 was the name. We said, no, we don't want to be called CLO. We wanted to retain our name as Nigeria Labour Congress. So that was the only thing we were able to, you know, to change in the founding constitution of Nigeria Labour Congress. So we said, look, don't worry. In 3 years' time, we'll go for another the same. Let's accept this. So that was where I was elected, you know, the founding president of Nigeria Labour Congress. And it used to be a three-year term, and no president can do more than two terms. And that tradition has up to now been maintained.
And you served for two terms?
I served for two terms, from February 28, 1978, to February 28, 1984.
Comrade, let's talk about collective bargaining. Yep. During the civilian administration of Alhaji Shehu Shagari, you started that fight for a minimum wage for the Nigerian worker.
Yeah.
What was the driving force, or rather, what was behind your mind when you set out on that fight?
First and foremost, my colleagues and I, because it's not just one. It's a collective. Our colleagues and I, we saw that over the years, there had not been a national minimum wage by law in Nigeria. Even since 1860 that you know, the British started to come here. You know, we have, in 1914, there has never been any national minimum wage. So one of the things that our administration decided to do was to win a minimum wage for Nigerian workers, and also to make May Day a public holiday. So we set ourselves some targets. So one of those targets was the national minimum wage, which we fought for in 1981, you know, which fortunately we were able to win a national minimum wage, which is binding on all sectors, whether public, private or parastatal, throughout the country.
That's
because
you see,
pardon?
That's the 150 naira.
Yes, that 150 naira at that time is more than almost 50,000 naira today. When you do the you know, the naira was stronger than the dollar, so it was something. And so it was, we asked for 300, and it was during negotiations, and we also didn't stop there. One of the things that we also did was not only to side with the Minister of Labour, when we had to go on strike for that. And part of the reason for calling off the strike is that there should be a negotiation that will be led by the Vice President on behalf of the government, the Senate President, the late Shola Saraki, the the Speaker of the House, Umeh Ezeoke, and then the Minister of Labour and so on and so forth. Because he wanted whatever might be agreed upon to be legislated in both House of the National Assembly so that it becomes law, which will be signed by the President. And that's exactly what happened.
Well, if you have just joined us, the program is Reflections, and we have our guest, the number one Labour man in Nigeria. That's talking about Comrade Hassan Sumunu, OON. We've been walking down memory lane, and he's been putting us on track on what happened in the early days. The program is still Reflections, and we still have our guest in the house, Comrade Hassan Sumunu. We want to find out, sir, during those years of struggle, what was your driving force?
First and foremost, I have to thank God, the Almighty God, for giving me a role model in the late Comrade Wahab Goodluck, under who I served as member of his union when he was General Secretary, and I later became President of the union when he was still General Secretary. And I never went to any trade union school. But what I learned in the 10 years that I worked closely with him, I could not find in any trade union university. Because one of the first things I learned from him, and I always teach it in even our workers' education program, not only in Nigeria, but also all over the continent of Africa and abroad, is the fact that a trade unionist should know a little bit about everything. So that shows that a trade unionist must be hungry for knowledge. And it was that driving force that made me to learn French. I speak French. When the Federal Minister of Works sent me for a course in Italy, we learned Italian for only 6 weeks, and we were there for that postgraduate course in highway engineering in Italy in 1975, January to June. And you know, we were taught Italian in 6 weeks, and we were using Italian on the field for the 6 months, and I speak Italian today. So, and you know, one of the things also, for instance, before IMF World Bank came with their social adjustment program, we were able to know everything that needs to be known about IMF and the World Bank, thanks to the likes of the late, Professor, what's his name now? Badi Onimode. Badi Onimode, you know, gave us everything we wanted to know about IMF and World Bank, their workings. So before their structural adjustment thing came, we were already more than prepared for them. So that is one of the things. Then I also learned about honesty and hard work, punctuality, commitment to work, and patriotism. I learned all those, not from any text of the thing, no. I learned it from Wahab Goodluck. He would be the first to be at work, and the last to go. So as president of his union, I was not on full time. I used to work, do my work, either as CEO or a higher technical officer, or even senior technical officer, Federal Minister of Works. At the end of the day, we would all come back to Aje to come and work in the union office, now in Aje Street. Work in the union office till at time 10 o'clock, 11 p.m. before we go back to our home. That, and nobody in Goodluck's office, no alcohol. Nobody's allowed to take alcohol in the trade union office when Goodluck was there. After office hours, you can go and drown yourself in a bar or something, that's your business, as long as you come to work promptly the following day. But to drink alcohol in the trade union office was anathema to him. So these are some of the values that one imbibes. For instance, And the governor of Edo State, the other Oshogbo, used to quote me on that. I said, one of the things I learned from him, he said, Goodluck said, when he was young, his father used to tell him, well, you know, always tell the truth. Always tell the truth. Then when he asked, why did you tell? He said, look, if you tell the truth, you will die. If you lie, you will die. So it's better to tell the truth and die by the truth. And when you go to heaven, you go to paradise instead of going to hell. So liars go to hell. Those who tell the truth. So that's all of it. And also, never, never to sell the workers. Sell out the workers. Because it's you don't need to be of any religious persuasion to know that when you sell out the workers, anybody who sells out the workers will call the wrath of God and of man. Because, you know, they are the ones sweating to make the checkoff for which a union secretary or whatever is paid. So to now betray them, because you see, by being elected, you are not the cleverest, you are not the best, you are not the oldest. It is confidence they have in you. It's this thing the workers see in you that you are going to do their own, that makes them to have confidence in you to elect you into the leadership of the trade union. So that confidence alone, if it is betrayed, what lies more like God is going to punish the person, anybody that betrays the workers. So that's one of the values that we learn and we imbibe.
Comrade, listening to all this, how does it then make you feel when you hear that labor leaders have sold out workers, labor leaders are compromised, labor leaders don't fight for their members anymore? How does it make you feel?
My heart bleeds, and bleeds for them because they don't know the karmic consequences of what they are doing. Let me tell you, a labor leader that serves well the workers is not likely to be rich, but it's going to be the richest. It's not likely to be rich in terms of saying, no, he has this, he has that, and so on.
Material gains.
But it may be in his good health that God is going to compensate him. It may be in the stability of his marriage that God is going to compensate him. It may be in his children doing well in whatever callings that they find themselves, that, you know, that is going to be compensated. Let me tell you, I've left Uatu now, over 2 years ago. I still have invitations throughout the continent and outside the continent for me and my wife to come and spend holidays at the expense of the affiliates of Uatu, you know, in even the All China Federation of Trade Unions. They say, look, Sumonu, you are going. But every year, anytime you want to come and spend 2 weeks of the day with your wife, the All China Federation of Trade Unions will pay your. I've made use of that opportunity once. I didn't go last year. I don't even know where I was going. So you see, what then? There was a time the Egyptian Trade Union Federation gave me my wife and my last two children, their daughters, 2 weeks holidays in Egypt at the expense of the Egyptian Trade Union Federation. I am telling you, it was the best holidays I ever had in my life. So that's why I say he may not be rich, but you will still be the richest. Because what you are going to have by way of, you know, appreciation of your little contribution, you know, it cannot be quantified in money, in monetary terms. That's why I say, look, when you serve very well, but look at those who betray the workers. You see their end. You will see their end.
Yeah, let's now talk about leadership.
Yeah.
What does leadership mean to you?
Leadership means service to me. Service. Because, as I told you, members have reposed confidence in you, not because you are the oldest, not because you are the cleverest, not because you are the best. They just see something in you that makes them to, you know, repose confidence in you and elect you into leadership. That is a responsibility for you to serve their interests and not your personal interests.
Yes, I was actually going to ask if that is now an opportunity for one to further his own nest.
No. No. It should be, leaders should be the opportunity to serve. To serve the interests of your constituents, those who elect you. To serve the interests of your country. To serve the interests of your people.
In doing all this,
yeah.
Do you have patriotism at the back of your mind?
Of course. Look, it is said that patriotism is part of faith. You cannot say you are a good Christian or a good Muslim if you don't love your country. You cannot say you love God if you don't love your country. So patriotism is part of faith. So you are going to be an infidel if you don't love your country, if you are not patriotic. And patriotism is not self-service. Patriotism is to serve the interests of the country and to defend the country. So I used to laugh when our armed forces say they have signed their lives to defend the country, even with but there are others also who also defend the interests of their country with their lives. We have been in situations where, you know, we could have compromised the interests of our country. But we didn't, because we love our country.
Comrade, sir.
Radicalism and labor unionism, are they inseparable?
Well, I don't know your meaning of radicalism.
Yes, always fighting the government.
No. You know, you see, trade unionists, well, are imbued with some radicalism. No question about that. Because if you are a mama put somebody, you cannot lead a trade union.
Yes.
Because you are leading those who are cleverer than you. You are leading those who are older than you. Those who are who even be our fathers. And the trade union movement, we are leading them. And the Yoruba say, you are leading Oritutu Oribigbe. You are leading, you know, fresh heads and dry heads. That is, you know, hot heads and those who cool heads. So you have to be in between. So when it comes to one of the things that you will notice a trade union is that first, a trade unionist can never stand any injustice anywhere he is. Even if his life will be at stake, he will not condone any injustice. So once anybody is beaten by that trade union bug, he will always fight injustice, whether at the level of the employer, at the shop floor level, or at the level of state, at the level of government, at any level. There was a time I had a quarrel in the United Nations with the, I think, Dutch ambassador on a matter affecting Africa. I insulted him. So the British ambassador then to the UN was then, you know, had been high commissioner to Nigeria. He knew me, it was then I was president of NLC. So he arranged a small coffee this year with me and the Dutch ambassador to now say, no, maybe what I thought the man meant, the man apologized to say that what he meant about Africa was not what, maybe the interpretation was not what, blah, blah, blah. So we part the thing over. So you are always ready to pounce on anybody that, you know, wants to either cheat or insult your country, your continent, your race, or your organization. You are ready to do anything to defend. Because any injustice, any insult, as a trade unionist, we cannot accept.
Okay, comrade, without really being judgmental, are you happy with the state of our labor unions these days?
Well, I'm not very happy. But the trade union is also the product of the society.
Yes.
So you cannot You cannot take them in isolation of what is happening in society. But we have a saying at home that Agbakiwa loja kori omotutuwo in Yoruba. It says, you know, as long as elders remain in the marketplace, there will be no baby on the back of his mother that we have his head or her head bent like this. There will be an old person to straighten the head of that child on the mother's head.
And you have been doing it.
And that's where, as long as we're alive, we have to.
Okay. We have to. So how do you advise the younger ones who are into unionism now for maybe their selfish gains or something?
No, we have to go back to the drawing boards. And we have been telling the current NSC leaders themselves, we have to go back to the drawing boards to actually strengthen workers' education. Because see, one of the things I teach in workers' education is trade union ethics. So you see, once we lose our ethics, then it will be easy to fall prey to societal, you know, mess as such, as I call it. But you know, in our days, we had education and education and education. As I told you earlier, you know, a trade unionist must know a little bit about everything. We concentrated on education, on you know, learning, on reading, on widening the frontiers of our knowledge. So you see, once you are widening the frontiers of your knowledge, all these material things will not be attractive to you again because you know the consequences of, you know, when you do this, you know, you cannot plant maize and reap cassava. It's what you sow that you will reap. So once in the trade union and workers' education program, we start to do that. All these aberrations, because I call them aberrations of the society, will not creep into the trade unions again.
So let us look at your tenure at the OATU.
Yeah.
How was it
then?
Well, I was elected first, our first, in OATU, there was no tenure, no term. In NSC, two terms. In OATU, you can do one term and they send you away. But the person who was the founding Secretary General of OATU, Dennis Akumu, is a Kenya. He served for 13 years. And when I was, in fact, I didn't want to go to Accra. I wanted to contest for the presidency of OATU because like that, I would still be in Nigeria, you know, helping our other colleagues of the NLC and so on and so forth. That was my, but you know, we had the election here. You remember the OATU election in 1985 in January, you know, in Lagos. The Libyans were holding the presidency of OATU at that time, and I was also calling for president. They said no. The whole thing, you know, you know, was divided into two. So we went for 13 months later. We went for a new election. The same thing happened until the African, the OU Labour and Social Affairs Commission, you know, appointed 5-member committee to look into the thing, and then there were NSC leadership. By then, I've left the NSC as president. It was Ali Chiroma who succeeded me, and they came. They sent a delegation to Ali Chiroma, and they later came to me and said, "Look, Sumanu, we don't want you as president of OATU, because as president of OATU, it's only when you only chair meetings. It's only when you are called to Accra you come. But we want you to come and you know use your experience that you have acquired and you know the service you are giving to Nigerian workers to come and give it to African workers as Secretary General in Accra." So when you know with a lot of persuasion from the late Comrade Goodluck and others, so that was how you know I was elected, you know, in October 1986 as Secretary General.
How was your tenure there?
I was elected and re-elected for 6 terms. I spent 26 years and 2 months as Secretary of OATU, and they didn't even want us to go. I said, look, by then, my colleagues and I were over 70. I said, look, we don't want to die on this job. So please. And it has not been easy, but one of the good things that our team was able to do in the 26 years is the fact that we consolidated, we built, God help us build, you know, a very strong superstructure on a very strong foundation laid by Dennis Akumu team, you know, in their, you know, as the founding secretariat of the OATU. So we built on it. For example, we made our mark in the OAU and the AU. You know, for instance, the OATU Secretary General is normally invited to all the summits of the OAU and the African Union now. So I attended for over 26 years summits of the OAU and AU, meeting different heads of state and so on. Then, you know, I also became a deputy presiding officer of ECOSOC, also of the AU. Then we built, with the support of our Chinese trade-owned colleagues, their government, and through them, their government built for us a new secretariat of the OATU in Accra, you know, with a conference hall of that can accommodate 200 people. And also, we were building the Kwame Nkrumah African Labour College, also in Accra, with the assistance also of the Chinese trade unions and their government. They helped us build the dormitory block of the Kwame Nkrumah African Labour College. We can take 176 students in residence. It's now in Accra. It's already. So we are, all the other governments that promised us later had problems like Libya, you know, Gaddafi before, you know, he was like Egypt, you know, Mubarak, you know, even Algeria and so on, that wanted to help build the classroom blocks. Otherwise, the Kwame Nkrumah African Labour College would have started. And we also developed a good rapport with a lot of international organizations and institutions, which makes, you know, the OATU dynamic. And also we had a very good Pan-African workers education programs that covers the whole continent in collaboration with our colleagues from other other countries in the world.
Comrade, let's look at collective bargaining and labor-government relations. Must there be a disruption for labor to make its mark? Must we always fight to make the mark?
Well, we must not always fight, but let me tell you, collective bargaining is not a tea party. Collective bargaining is giving and taking. Yes. It is not in the old days of labor unionism, or it's Emerson must go, in the old railway, Emerson must go. No. It's now you have to bring facts and figures from your side. The government has to bring, or whichever employer you are negotiating, has to bring, you know, its own facts and figures. And then you start to negotiate. You give and take. But immediately you arrive at an agreement, and you sign an agreement, it is binding on the two parties to implement to the letter such agreement. For example, I'm sorry to say, our governments, particularly federal, have been very notorious in not, you know, implementing agreements that have been reached in collective bargaining with unions. The question of ASU is a case in point. So you see, it's one where you renege on your promise. It's a very, very bad thing. It damages industrial relations. It weakens confidence. There are so many, look, in our time, apart from the strike that we had to go, only 3 days for the minimum wage, I would say 2 or 3 days for the national minimum wage. We never, in the 6 years I was president of NSA, we never went on strike. Because, you see, we had good rapport and relationship. There are a lot of things you can do through, you know, good relations with the employers. For instance, at the start of the NSA, most of the industrial unions have not taken off. So, particularly in the private sector, most of the private sector employers were not, you know, they didn't want to even recognize the checkoff that was automatic in the decree 22. So I had to phone the NECA person to say, look, your people, this is what they are doing. So instead of going to negotiation or going on strike in that particular company, because of our relationship with the Director General of NECA, the NECA Director General will call his own boys, you know, to obey the laws of the country and get those things sorted out. The same thing, if also our members also want to be exuberant and we also, you know, call them, say, look, don't destroy the bridge that we have delicately built between us and the employers. So that, you know, whatever is the case, go and sort it out. If you have a problem, call us.
In other words, patriotism was at the back of whatever you were doing.
Not only patriotism, but also, you know, good relationship, good neighborliness, and also, you know, I don't know, we call it Osun State here, Omoluabi. When you are a gentleman, you know, a gentleman's word must be his bond. So if you say yes, your yes must be yes. And if it is no, let your no be no. And then you can then, you know, negotiate and reach agreement. But once you reach agreement, either party are under obligation to fulfill whatever agreement they reach. Because negotiation, you don't do negotiation, you know, with the gun. No, each of them voluntarily, you know. And then in negotiations, there is no master, no servant. When you're on the negotiating table, you are equal partners. It's not a question, I'm government. No. If you are government, you are government in your state house or your so-and-so rock. But when you are negotiating for this thing, you became equal. Because negotiation between two unequal partners is like negotiation between a cat and a mouse. And nobody's going to recognize, you know, who will win. The cat will always win in any negotiation with the mouse. So negotiation presupposes equality. And then whatever is negotiated,
well, comrade, we wish you well in retirement. You're still looking very strong. I'm sure that you equally give us more service in this country. Thank you very, very much. And viewers, that is where we actually come to the end of the program today. We have been tapping from the experiences of the first president of the NLC, comrade Hassan Adebayo Sumunu, OON. We've been walking down memory lane with him, and we want to thank him again for accepting to talk with us today. And we also want to thank you for staying on to listen to this program. Until we come your way again, same time, I am Walter Naji, thanking you on behalf of my colleagues here in the studio. And thank you very much, sir.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
It's a pleasure meeting
you.
Choose a candidate of your choice through the ballot. NTA, the largest TV network in Africa, brings to you live pictures and analysis of the electioneering process as Nigeria decides.